Thanksgiving. This is the time of year when I preach, and I started this about 3 years ago, so this will be the fourth time that I've preached this sermon. Now, it's not the exact sermon, so if you were here, you don't need to get up and leave. You were here last year for that. It's a little different, but it's based on the same scripture and the same title of the sermon. The title of the sermon is Come Before Winter. As the leaves start changing and falling off the trees, and as the temperature starts to get crisp and cool and sometimes a little chilly, this sermon comes to my mind. And it's a sermon that has touched my heart and has touched the lives of many others. And so today I want to share it with you again. How many of you have ever watched a movie? And you get into the movie, and the movie is amazing, it's fantastic, and it grips you, and you love what's happening, or you're fearing what's about to happen, and then about the time when it builds and builds and builds to that crescendo, the credits start to roll. Have you ever been to a movie like that? I go, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? And you never know what happened. The female lead in the movie is in a coma, and her husband is by her bed, and he's crying out, and he says, please come back to me. And then the credits start to roll. You don't know if she lived or if she died. I hate those kind of movies. It leaves you hanging. I don't like to be left hanging. Well, today the sermon is about regret. And you say, how do you get from that, what you were just talking about, to regret? Well, hang on, you'll see. You'll see, it's coming. But regret is a universal experience. Every one of us at one time or another has experienced some kind of regret in our lives. In fact, I would say if you've never experienced regret, you're lying. Just to be real. I think every one of us has said, I wish I could have, I should have, all of those things. And there are two types of regret, by the way. Two types of regret. The first one is where you've done something, and then you say, boy, that was pretty stupid. If I had a chance to do that again, I would sure do it differently. I really regret what I said or what I did, that kind of thing. In fact, as you know, I was in the Army for a few years, and during that time as a chaplain in the Army, I had the opportunity to minister to the inmates at the United States Disciplinary Barracks at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. Now that is the only Department of Defense maximum security prison in the United States. And all branches of service, Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marine, and I think we even had some Coast Guard folks that were there, folks that get court-martialed and then get a sentence of 5 years or more go to the USDB. And I will tell you that while I was there, I saw a lot of regret on the faces of the men and women who were incarcerated there. People who were good people, who were doing the right things, and then out of nowhere, they did something that they, out of passion or out of anger or out of whatever, they made one mistake. And it cost them virtually everything that they have except their life. And some of them were on death row as a result of that. There were about five or six inmates when I was there that were awaiting execution. And so every one of these, for the most part, only did one thing wrong. But their regret is so great because of that. That's the first type of regret. That's not the one we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about the second type, which is where we should have done something and we failed to do it, and then it was too late. We couldn't do it. We waited too long, or we hesitated too much. And today, that's the type of regret I want to talk about. And it's about everyone who's ever uttered the words, I should have, I wish I had done, fill in the blank, I wish I'd have said. It's about all the woulda, coulda, shouldas that fill our lives. It's about every good intention that's not followed up with a good deed. Every one of us, every person in this room, I believe, who's lived for more than a few years and made plans to do something and then failed to follow through, maybe until it was too late. Well, that's what our scripture passage is all about. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning with verse 9. If you need a Bible, we have a rack of Bibles in the back. You're welcome to borrow one while you're here today. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 9 through, we're going to go all the way through 22, so bear with me here. Remember, this is a letter written to Timothy. And it goes like this: do your best to come to me soon. For Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia. Titus to Dalmatia. Luke alone is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, for he's very useful to me for ministry. Verse 12, Tychicus I have sent to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas. Also the books, and above all, the parchments. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will repay him according to his deeds. Beware of him yourself, for he strongly opposed my message. At my first defense, no one came to stand by me, but all deserted me. May it not be charged against them. But the Lord stood by me and strengthened me, so that through my message, the message might be fully proclaimed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. So I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every deed, an evil deed, and bring me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet Prisca and Aquila and the household of Onesiphorus. Erastus remained at Corinth, and I left Trophimus, who was ill, at Miletus. Do your best to come before winter. Eubulus sends greetings to you, as do Pudens and Linus and Claudia and all the brothers. The Lord be with your spirit. Grace be with you. Listen, the Apostle Paul is nearing the end of his life. He knows that he's not long for this world. Not only is he up in age, but he is sitting in prison in Rome, waiting for the verdict to come down from Nero, the emperor. Now, Nero was an evil, evil ruler. And he took great delight in torturing and killing Christians. When you think about hearing about those Christians who died in the Colosseum and were being fed to the lions, this is Nero who was doing that kind of thing. And Paul knew that he had been arrested falsely because of his faith and because of his refusal to bow down to this emperor Nero. He knew that because of that, that he was destined for the executioners. And so he's writing this letter to Timothy, very likely the last letter that he will ever write. And he concludes with some personal requests. Verse 9, he said, come to me soon. Verse 11, get Mark and bring him with you. Verse 13, when you come, bring my cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas. Verse 13, bring my books and especially my parchments. And verse 21, do your best to come before winter. What did Timothy do to fulfill Paul's request? We don't know, because shortly after this letter was written, the credits rolled. We don't know how it ended. What we do know is that part of the reason for Paul's anxiousness is because he's all alone. He says that everybody's left me except for Luke. Oh, Luke. Luke was his constant companion. He was one of his best friends, and he was with him all the time. And Luke did not abandon him when the tough got going. Those with whom he had been ministering had abandoned him out of fear of persecution. Timothy is a long way away, and it would require Timothy to book passage on a ship in order to get to Rome in time to see Paul before winter set in, because if he waited until winter time came, he would miss the opportunity until spring. He would not be able to catch a ship until springtime, because the ships did not sail in the wintertime because of winter storms that would often shipwreck the ships that were traveling. And so they would just avoid that altogether and not travel during the winter months. And because of that, then Paul knew that if Timothy didn't get on a ship soon and get there, that he very likely would never see him again. You know, we have no record of Timothy's visit. It's very likely that sometime in December of that year, the Apostle Paul was put to death. He was beheaded. If Timothy did have to wait until spring, it would be too late. His father in the faith, Paul, would already be dead. Remember, I said this sermon is about regret. Failing to do something that we need to do, that we should do. Let's look at this letter to see if we can discover some truths for us today and some encouragement for us today. The first thing I see in here is that we must seize moments of opportunity. We must seize moments of opportunity. Opportunities don't come along every day. And sometimes when they come along, if we don't jump on them, if we don't seize them, then they may pass us by. Delay, these things will be forever out of our grasp. In this letter, there's a brief moment of opportunity for Timothy to come to Paul. Delay is not an option. You know, I think it's interesting. We send flowers to people when they die. You know? That's always been a curious thing. I mean, you know, you go to funerals and there's flowers everywhere and all of that. But the person that's in the casket is not enjoying any of those flowers. Had you sent those a week before or 2 weeks before, they would have enjoyed those perhaps on their table or in a spray in their living room or something like that. But today, they're not enjoying them at all, but we send the flowers anyway. And you know, florists do a big business out of regret. They really do. You know, because we feel bad because we didn't go to see them before they died. We didn't recognize them for who they were in our lives and what they had done for us in our lives until it was too late. And so we do the very best thing that we can. We send flowers. They even have special trucks that carry flowers of regret in funerals. 2 Sundays ago, a crazed gunman walked into a church in Sutherland Springs, Texas, and systematically began executing people who had gathered for worship. Now listen, I'm sure that the people that got up that morning and went to that church had no idea that this might be their last day on earth. Yet for 26 people in that church, that Sunday was their final day alive. 26 people. For those who were left behind, do you think that maybe there were some regrets? Do you suppose that there were some things that should have been said to some of those 26 people? It was never said. It was never spoken. Do you suppose there were things that should have been done for those people before that day? That somebody meant to do, they meant to get over there, they meant to make the phone call, they meant to do something, but it's too late. You see, regret is a universal experience. But it doesn't have to be. It doesn't have to be today. Brothers and sisters, we have opportunities today. The first one of these I see is that we have opportunities to believe. Maybe you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. And you say, well, I'm going to get around to that someday. Right now I'm living my life and I'm having a good time. But, you know, I know that I need to do it. And someday I might get around to that. Sometimes someday never comes. Maybe your opportunity today is an opportunity to love. Maybe it's time to demonstrate love to others. Maybe your opportunity today is an opportunity to serve. Maybe this is your time to serve God and to serve those around you. God has put into you a unique gifting. You are an individual, unique in and of yourselves. In fact, you're so unique that nobody has your DNA. But God has created you uniquely you. I heard this the other day. I said, don't try to be somebody you're not. Just be yourself. Everybody else is taken. But seriously, God has created you today with a unique opportunity to serve Him exactly the way that He designed you to serve Him. But you've been putting that off. You've been letting opportunities like that go by. Maybe today is your opportunity to serve. Maybe it's your opportunity to give. You know, you've been meaning to give to God. Maybe this is your time to give in an outrageous way. Trusting God to do something special with your hilarious giving. Maybe today is an opportunity for you to forgive someone. Someone has hurt you, and you've been holding on to that grudge and that hurt and that anger too long, and it's become a roadblock to your ability to move on. Maybe today is your day to forgive, to let it go. Maybe it's your opportunity to show gratitude to someone. Maybe today is the day to make that phone call or make that visit and tell somebody who's made a significantly positive impact on your life. Let them know that. Make their day today. 2 summers ago, Renee, my wife, had a strong desire, a strong urging within her to go to Tampa, Florida, our hometown, and visit two of her aunts, her aunt and uncle on her father's side and an aunt on her mother's side. And she couldn't get it out of her mind, and she said, we need to go. I know it's a long way. I know I have these issues with my health, and I can't make a long road trip, so we plan to fly there. And she was able to visit with these people who I could say today are no longer with us. They have gone on to be with the Lord. The last one dying just a week or so ago. Didn't wait till it was too late. She said, I need to go now. I need to take care of this now. We've been talking about grace this quarter. And this may be your last chance to do the right thing or to say the right thing. This may be your last chance to forgive somebody. It may be your last chance to show grace, to offer grace to someone. You see? Tomorrow might be your Sutherland Springs, or might be their Sutherland Springs moment. If so, tomorrow may be too late. So we must seize moments of opportunity. The second thing I see is that we must never quit. We must never quit. Look at verse 10 here. It says, for Demas, in love with this present world, has deserted me and gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia. Titus to Dalmatia. Listen, these were some of Paul's closest friends, but they've all given up on him. When the pressure was on, they bailed. No one ever said that being a Christian was going to be easy, all right? If somebody told you that, they lied to you. The Bible says not if you are persecuted, it says when you are persecuted, you will be persecuted. So no one ever said being a Christian was going to be easy. I've heard all my life, when times get tough, the tough get going. That's the way I've heard it said. But apparently here, in this case, when times get tough, the weak go to Thessalonica or Galatia or to Dalmatia. How many people do you know that were one time sold out for Jesus? They were on fire for the Lord. They couldn't go a day without talking about Him. But now, they seldom mention that name, except maybe in a curse word. They're living for themselves. They're living for worldly pleasures. But listen, now more than ever is not the time to be in love with the present world as Demas was. Now is not the time to replace your relationship with God with a relationship with worldly pleasures. Jesus himself said in Matthew 24, 12, and 13, he said, "And because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold." And look at this next verse. It says, "But the one who endures to the end will be saved." Now, before you jump on that and say, "Wait a minute, are you saying that in order to be saved, we have to endure to the end?" Okay, well, that's getting the cart before the horse. Because what I see in that verse is that if you are saved, if you truly are a Christian, if you are a follower of Christ, there's no doubt that you will endure to the end. So your endurance to the end is the proof of your salvation, not the way to your salvation. These guys clearly were friends of Paul's. They had heard his teaching. They had heard him proclaim Christ and him crucified. Yet many of them left. Except for Luke, all of them left him. Left him alone there in prison awaiting his certain fate. This is no time to turn away from God and toward worldly pleasures. Now more than ever is no time to quit. The third thing I see in here is that when the call comes, will you go? That's a question that you need to answer for yourself. When the call comes, will you go? One of the last recorded words of the Apostle Paul are found in verse 31, and it was the simple words. It's where we get the title for this sermon, and it's simply this: do your best to come before winter. Do your best to come before winter. You see, we got to be ready at a moment's notice. As far as we know, Timothy, Paul's son in the faith, did not respond to the call to his spiritual father. And as far as we know, he waited too late. And I'm sure that if that's the case, then he had huge regrets. I don't know about you, but I don't want to live a life full of regrets. Let me ask you a question. As winter approaches, is it going to be a season of regret for you or a season of hope? Don't wait until it's too late. Don't wait until after the last ship has sailed. Don't wait to speak to a friend or loved one about the most important things in life and in death. Don't wait to speak to someone you love about Jesus. Listen, every one of us in this room has people that we love who are not going to go to heaven when they die. And yet we don't talk to them about Jesus. We don't encourage them. It's as if we want them to go to hell. Imagine with me, the Apostle Paul is now in heaven. The one who wrote while he was in chains is now free of every chain. There are no more sorrows, no more regrets for him. Every tear has been wiped away from his eyes. And Paul is sitting there and he hears footsteps in the hallways of heaven. And he says, "Is that you, Timothy?" "Yes, Paul, it's me. Sorry, but I did not come before winter, and I regret that." What is it you've been holding back from God? What is it that you've been putting off in your life? What is God asking you to bring to him that you've held back? Maybe it's a secret sin that you don't want to let go of. Maybe it's a relationship that you're holding on to. It's been toxic for you and you need to let it go. You need to give that to God before it's too late. Maybe it's a calling God has on your life, but you've been keeping God at arm's length, saying, "No, God, I'm not going to do that now. I might do it later, but I'm not going to do it now." Maybe God has asked you to bring your wayward children to him, but you've been holding back, trying to figure things out on your own. Maybe it's salvation. You know you need to surrender your life to God, but you're in love with the world so much that you can't let go of that in order to come to God today. Let me just say this. Today is the day. Today is that day. Don't put it off another day. Don't put it off any longer. Don't wait. Don't delay. We don't know what tomorrow holds. Tomorrow we may find ourselves in a church like the church at First Baptist Sutherland Springs, and someone comes in and our life is snuffed out. Or we get on the interstate to drive home and the car runs into us, or we lose control and our life is over. We don't know what tomorrow holds. Bring it to Jesus today. With one